Every day, we go about our lives without thinking about the unexpected events that may occur. But what if you found yourself in an emergency medical situation? Wound packing, chest seals, and tourniquets are critical skills that can help save a life. By learning these critical skills, you can be prepared to help in a life-threatening situation and potentially save a life. That's why One Source Search and Rescue was originally created. Thank you for joining us today. We hope you enjoy our training.
Hello, I'm Andrew Mavar, a nationally and state registered EMT in the state of California. I am the proud owner of One Source Search and Rescue and a military contractor, believe it or not, for the United States Army as well. I received my education through the American EMT Academy as well as the American Heart Association. And around that time, I decided to pursue a career in the medical field and with the various roles in the emergency response community and also to help educate the community. Over the past decade or so, I served as a 911 ambulance operator. I worked in critical care transports, acted as an operations manager for an ambulance company, and served as an infantryman for the United States Army for 8 impactful years. I'm a certified instructor through the American Heart Association. I'm also certified in tactical combat casualty care, basic life support, that is actually my specialty in the American Heart Association, as well as their Heart Saver classes. I have my advanced life support certificate, and also I have had the privilege to be affiliated with esteemed organizations like ASA TechMed, North American Rescue, Dark Angel Medical, NDFT training, this is why we're doing this collaboration, and much more. Also in my military service, I did wildland firefighting with Cal Fire with the Task Force Rattlesnake crew up in like Central Northern California area. I also did counter drug operations with the Army National Guard, as well as the various law enforcement agencies, local and federal agencies. So I want to just, you know, welcome you guys in this comprehensive two-part series on vital trauma care. Okay. My goal here is to equip you guys with the right tools to better prepare yourself for those types of situations. I normally teach response organizations, corporations, educational institutions, community centers, and even private individuals like your guys' selves today, with the aiming of giving you these life-saving skills. In this engaging series, I will take you through the intricacies of applying chest seals, wound packing, pressure dressings, and tourniquets. Okay, so those are the four topics we're gonna cover. As you can tell, my approach is very relaxed and approachable. Okay, however, while maintaining a professional focus, so I'm gonna have that focus there for you guys. The material will be presented via PowerPoint presentations, videos, hands-on demonstrations, as far as the demonstrations on my end, and in-depth lectures. Okay, all the information provided is basically rooted in research facts, as well as my personal experiences and knowledge as an EMT and a military professional. Okay, so we'll go over a little bit of the course. So the first part of this series is going to be focusing on the critical applications of the chest seals and the wound packing. The second part, though, will delve into the complexities of pressure dressings and tourniquet use. Moreover, though, I'll provide actual demonstrations, as mentioned before, on how to correctly apply chest seals, pack wounds, use pressure bandages, and apply tourniquets. This hands-on aspect, though, for you guys is aiming to give you a robust understanding of these life-saving techniques. So also, I want you guys to know that, remember, this series It's just not about acquiring new skills. It's about the understanding of the responsibilities that comes with these skills. Okay. While I bring a wealth of knowledge and experience to the table, it is crucial to always seek the professional medical guidance when faced with these emergencies. So without further ado, let's go ahead and go on this journey together, becoming more confident, more prepared, and skilled in handling these trauma situations. So together, we can save lives. So stay tuned. We're gonna jump right into the chest seal portion of the class. Alrighty, welcome back. We are gonna start diving into these training sessions. We're about to start part one, which is going to cover the intro to chest seals and wound packing. Specifically right now, we are gonna be covering chest seals, okay? So we're gonna start understanding the learning objectives. So the learning objectives for today is going to be understanding chest seals, chest seal types, evaluating chest seals, the chest seal application, and the key takeaways, okay? I just wanna note too, if I'm looking off the screen or off to the right of the screen, most likely it's because I have a ton of notes to go over, and I wanna give you the best bullet points that I could potentially pull, as well as the best information I can pull for you guys so you get the best out of your money. Just a firm understanding for part one and part two, this is a beginner's class, okay? So we're gonna go over beginner level stuff. We do offer advanced classes, and that's going to be happening later down the road. All right, so moving forward into the chest seal introduction. Okay, so the primary function, okay, of these chest seals, the crucial purpose of these chest seals is twofold. Okay, firstly, you're going to be using it to ensure the prevention of the lung from collapsing. A common consequence of an open chest wound is that lung collapsing. Secondly, though, it also is going to aid in averting tension pneumothoraxes. Tension pneumothorax, very simple. It's air that's going to cause that lung to collapse. That is what you call a tension pneumothorax. Pneumo means lungs. Okay. Now, obviously, there's tension. There's, you know, tension in that area. A severe and potentially fatal condition, which that is, where air pressure builds in the chest cavity. So you have negative pressure in your chest cavity. You allow air in, you get that positive pressure coming in. Chest seals, though, therefore, are vital in any emergency management of chest trauma, because you want to protect the patient from life-threatening complications, as well as enhancing the chances of survival. So you wanna boost that survival rate up high as you can get it, okay? And on the screen, you can see that is a chest seal. It's the North American High Vent Heat Chest Seal. There's tons of them, we're about to go over it. Okay, so first, before we go over these chest seals, what causes the need for a chest seal? Well, there's a few things. So the causes for chest seals, at least the requirements, chest seals are required in situations basically where traumatic injuries happen, leading to holes in the chest, such as gunshot wounds, stab wounds, shrapnel injuries, which can happen in a lot of places nowadays. These injuries can allow air to enter the chest cavity. So this is your chest cavity, okay? With that being said, and it can cause potentially life-threatening conditions known as a tension pneumothorax. There's also a thing in here that's called a hemothorax, which means blood in the lungs, which could also cause, or at least blood near the lungs, could also cause the lung collapse, or to collapse. Now, the use of chest seals for a sucking chest wounds. We're gonna go over what a sucking chest wound sounds like here shortly. On a graphic video. We do have graphic videos and images in all these classes, so I will prep you guys basically before we go there. So a sucking chest wound refers to an open chest wound that draws inside air, or draws in, yeah, inside air, I mean outside air, with in the chest cavity with each breath. So every time you breathe, it comes in. The chest seals are specifically designed to stop this by preventing air from entering that area. It's what it's an occlusive dressing, and we'll go over that in a brief minute here. And it's to prevent it from going through the wound. This function allows the affected lung to either re-expand and reduce the risk of further injury. So that's very important. So just a fair warning, I'm gonna be showing you what a sucking chest wound looks like.
Here's the chest wound.
Okay, with what you just saw, that is a sucking chest wound. Okay, that is actually one of my patients that I've had in the past. Keep in mind, we are medical professionals here. I do follow HIPAA, and anything that I show you is going to be HIPAA compliant. These are all for those teaching videos. So occlusive dressings, okay, we're gonna go over occlusive dressings. Occlusive dressing, as you would see on screen, is an adhesive dressing for wounds to create an airtight seal, okay? Constructed from material like plastic, hydrocolloid, and silicone. You can use Ziploc baggies, pretty much. Anything you can find that's plastic, you can use it. The pros to these though, okay, so the pros of this, seals wounds, okay, so it's gonna seal those wounds and prevent contamination and further damage. They're versatile for different wound types, including burns, lacerations, and surgical incisions. Lacerations is a cut. It also allows for easy removal and replacement during the wound care. The cons to this though, prolonged use can cause skin malcerations, so skin issues, especially if you might be allergic to that adhesive too. It also can cause welts, delay in healing. It may restrict the adequate ventilation, which sounds weird, but it does do that potentially, and it also will cause that slower healing factor of that. Now, the improper application of pressure bandage, the occlusive dressing, okay, can cause issues. If it's not infrequently changed, or it can cause potentially a higher risk for infection. So as well as self-adhesive bandages, okay, self-adhesive bandages are what I just said, the high venti chest seal, that's self-adhesive. It sticks to it versus an occlusive dressing where you have to apply tape, okay? So similar to occlusive dressings though, but with enhanced adhesion, like I mentioned, they're designed to securely attach to the skin even under wet or dirty conditions. So that's pretty sweet. So the pros to this is that the chest seal, once again, prevents air from entering into the chest, causing a collapsed lung. It's an easy application in emergency situations, which I'll be demoing it and showing you how actually easy it is. And it aids in the patient's stabilization prior to additional medical attention. Okay, so the cons to this, however, are roughly about the same cons. Might be not suitable for all types of chest wounds. It require correct application to be effective, and the availability may be limited in some medical settings. If you have it, then you should be good, but obviously you're gonna work with what you've got depending on the situation you get thrown into. So the choice factor of all these, you have different types of wounds and you'd want to apply them for the specific wounds. Okay, a hole in the chest is a hole in the chest. Use what you got, honestly. If you do have two wounds, you got to do the exit and the entry wound as well. One might be bigger than the other, so you have to might use multiple. It all just depends. Okay. So now I'm going to demonstrate how to properly apply a chest seal. So stay tuned and I will be right back with you guys. So I hope you guys enjoy this video. Alrighty, welcome to the chest seal demo video. It's gonna be pretty straightforward. and it shouldn't take too long. Just want to go over something. So a chest seal basically are going to be used typically, at least when there's a suspicion of like a penetrating chest wound that could potentially cause a tension pneumothorax or a pneumothorax, which once again is air leaking into the chest cavity basically to cause that lung to collapse. So the signs that can indicate the need for a chest seal include penetrating chest trauma, like a stabbing, gunshot wound, or an impaled object, etc. Difficulty breathing or shortness of breath, rapid heart rate, decreased or absent breath sounds on the affected side, if you have a stethoscope, and cyanosis, which is a bluish coloration of like the skin due to poor circulation or inadequate oxygen. Okay, so for this demonstration, go ahead and we're gonna pull out your chest seals from either the kit that you purchased or whatever you guys already currently have and pull it out. I already have some pulled out stuff, so you're gonna kind of basically see all this, how it's gonna be. I'm gonna pull out my ASA Tech Med chest seal. We've already got out. It's gonna come with two things. It's gonna be having the gauze as well as the chest seal itself. I don't have my shears today, unfortunately, but thankfully I've already cut the shirt. So I'm gonna be simulating shears with my finger. Shears are pretty cheap. You can find them pretty much anywhere for fairly cheap. So once again, with those signs and symptoms in mind, the usually dead giveaway is it's like a gunshot victim. So we're gonna just play as this is a gunshot victim. So I'm gonna go ahead and expose the wound, okay? So once I expose this wound on the chest right here, I'm going to obviously inspect it, as well as inspect the back for this training purpose. Since I'm on a table, I'm not gonna flip my guy backwards, but we're only gonna say he only has one wound. Once again, prior to us with this demonstration, I went over with, if there was two holes, you plug both, basically, seal both. So go ahead and moving forward. If your patient is conscious, you're gonna ask the patient to exhale. The reason why you do that is you wanna get as much air as you can outside of this chest, okay? Or the chest cavity. If he is unconscious and he's breathing, you're going to wait until that exhale, even if it's really short exhales, you're gonna wait, okay? So what you're gonna basically do is open up your packaging, which will look similar to this, okay? Once you apply this, this is once again a self-adhesive chest seal. If you do not have that and you have only an occlusive dressing, okay? Whether that be a plastic Ziploc baggie or basically a wrapper or a petroleum gauze, you'd slap that petroleum gauze, making sure it's down like so, and you'd cover that wound. So what you're gonna do for training purposes, I'm not gonna peel this off because it is very, very sticky. And it is a pain in the butt to get off. So what I'm gonna do is wipe away all the blood or any froth that you see. It looks like a milk frother, but with blood. There is four holes in this ASA Tech Med chest seal, which I don't mind and I definitely prefer. I slap it on there, just like so, and I'm gonna seal it and basically go around as much as I can. Obvious reasons, it's not sticking because there's plastic around it. But your goal is to get to the center of the chest, okay? On that exhale. Once they exhale and you place this chest seal on, you either have this to the side or however you want it. It doesn't really matter. As long as that chest seal goes on. What you're gonna do is I have the tendency to put the the collapsed lung upwards to the sky or whichever side it may be on. So it has time to expand. So you don't have to worry about it having problems trying to expand. So you can either do the left recumbent lateral position or the right lateral recumbent position. It is basically when you tilt this dummy on its side, and the best way I can demonstrate it is actually doing it. So we're gonna move it just a little bit so you can kind of get a feel for it. So you're gonna basically have this person on his side. Let's just say it is his left lung that has collapsed. You're gonna basically bring his leg out just like this, and it's gonna lay flat, and that arm can be over here, okay? So once he's laying there, you basically observe the patient the entire time, making sure you're good. But that's basically it. That's really easy on how you apply a chest seal, okay? Obviously you document, and you kind of just go from there. If you have a pulse ox, which is a pulse extremity, totally saying that wrong. But if you have that, anything between 95 and above on the percentage is good. If it's lower, you'd want to give them oxygen. Obviously, if they're not breathing, you would want to give them CPR. You could either do a bag valve mask or just breaths, or compressions as well as the breaths. That's another thing. But thank you for watching this chest seal training video. And once again, it's very simplistic, not too hard. As far as burping goes, I mentioned burping before. If you have one of these, okay, and it's occlusive dressing, tape it on three sides, preferably the side that I will do it probably on this side. If it's on his right or left, you just go on the opposite side and you tape it. But burping, so once you seal it, you can either seal it on all sides and just burp it on exhale, which is basically just pulling it up and letting all that excess go, or you seal it on three sides, letting it go, but make sure you get it as tight as you can if you do it on three sides. Enough to where it will actually allow the fluid to ooze out. And then if there's an issue, you can just burp it. You basically pull it up and peel, and that's it. Okay, tape it down once again. And that is pretty much it. If you need multiple chest seals, you can do multiple chest seals. Your goal is to establish his lungs to be good without collapsing. But thank you once again for watching, and that is gonna be it for the chest seal video. All right, thank you for watching that video. I really hope that was very informative. This is going to be the chest seal conclusion. So I am just gonna go ahead and go further on. All right, so the overall conclusion. So roles of a chest seal, they're a crucial tool for managing life-threatening injuries, or at least life-threatening penetrating chest injuries, okay? It helps enhance survival by sealing the wound to prevent further damage. Very simple, okay? The types of chest seals, okay? We have two options, vented and non-vented. Simple as that. The choice basically depends on the patient's need, okay? The importance of training. Always do training. Training. I cannot stress it enough. Muscle memory is key. Proper application is key too. It's just crucial. It requires this professional training that I'm giving you guys. So demonstration. My demonstration of applying these chest seals includes cleaning and drying the wound area, creating an airtight seal around the wound. Okay. And push them in the recovery position and whatnot. Okay. So as far as the scenario application, so considering chest seal use during initial assessment and management of penetrating chest injuries. Infection control is something to always consider with dealing with any blood, whether it be eye protection, which is also known as eye pro, or gloves, okay, which is also PPE. Both of those are considered PPE, personal protective equipment, okay? So always adhere to your infection control procedures. Just wear the appropriate personal protective gear. Okay, now you're asking me potentially, what if I don't have that? Okay, if you have open wounds on your hands, go to the doctor, get checked out. But also, you wanna keep in mind bloodborne pathogens are a huge thing. If you don't have cuts on your hands or any open wounds or sores, wash your hands or use hand sanitizer. If you don't have soap and water, just hand sanitizer, lather that on there really good. Then when you get a chance, go to a sink, wash your hands with warm soapy water and you should be fine. Now in conclusion, so chest seals significantly improve the outcome in an emergency management of penetrating chest injuries, okay? Reducing more morbidity and mortality rates, okay? Now, that is pretty much it. So I will be taking questions. You could always email me at amavarcel. I'll say that one more time. That's A as in apple, M is a Mary, A is an Apple, V is a Victor, AR at onesourcesearchrescue.com, or you can visit us at www.onesourcesearchrescue.com, and you could scroll through our website. We have a blog that we publish every Saturday. Sometimes it gets delayed, but it's 90% of the time it's every Saturday. I have medical kits up there for these classes, as well as actual medical kits. We do custom kits. And if you're local to my area, which is in San Bernardino County or Southern California, and you want to book a class with us, I do a 30-minute phone consultation to figure out everything, and I come to you. Okay, so with that, keeping that in mind, after every section, I will re-bring up my website and everything like that to help you guys out. But now we are going to go ahead and start with wound packing and wound care. Hello and welcome back to the part one series, but section number two. Okay, this is going to be about wound packing and wound care. Okay, so stuff at least that we're going to be going over is going to be, we're going to understand the fundamentals of chest seals. Okay, the chest seal varieties. We're going to be assessing chest seals. Chest seal application practical. That's what we're going to be end up doing, which is the demo. And then we're going to be summarizing basically the key takeaways. So without further ado, let's go ahead and continue. All right. So as mentioned before, this is going to be the wound packing segment. So what is wound packing? Okay. So the definition of wound packing is wound packing is the procedure basically of placing gauze or a similar material into a wound, whether that be big or small. The purpose of it though is it serves dual purposes. Okay, so it's gonna control the bleeding by exerting pressure. And the second thing is gonna be it absorbs excess fluid to prevent infection, thereby promoting wound healing. Okay, and you're gonna be also stopping the clot. Okay, as you can see on the screen, that is what combat gauze looks like. I use it all the time. There's different types of gauzes out there, and there's a ton of benefits to it, okay? All right, so we're gonna continue into the wound packing portion. Wound packing is going to be a critical part in life-saving, okay? So a critical technique used in the management of deep wounds involves filling the wound with sterile gauze, okay, or similar, you know, materials, whether that be hemostatic gauze or different types of gauze. The purpose of wound packing, okay, to control bleeding, to stop the bleed campaigns, they're everywhere, and to promote clotting, okay. We're also going to be reducing the risk of shock and other complications. I'll go into shock further down in the lesson, probably most likely in part two. Now, also prevent further blood loss. You don't want a lot of blood to be lost, and I'll show you why here shortly. And the importance of wound packing. My tongue tied today. So the importance is essential. Okay, it's an essential skill for first responders, healthcare professionals. You guys are individuals, at least, that might be involved in that. And nowadays, active shooters are everywhere. So you very well might be involved in one of those. And being that first responder in those emergency care situations. It's particularly effective in managing severe wounds caused by gunshot wounds or knife wounds, like lacerations. You'll be going fingers deep into these wound cavities and whatnot. So it is definitely something to consider that you might have to do. And gloves, highly recommend gloves, okay? So continuing forward, okay, so wound packing effectiveness studies, okay? So studies indicate it's an effective way in controlling the bleeding through The success basically varies, though, on injury-specific provider skill and the other factors. I do want to note, though, too, only trained medical professionals should perform this technique. However, in exigent circumstances like active shooters and whatnot, and you do have your stuff and you do prep yourself, then you should be fine. There's a thing called the Good Samaritan Law. Good Samaritan Law protects anybody who does not have the medical professional stuff, where like myself, where I have an EMT license, state and nationally recognized. Same thing with doctors. We have malpractice insurance. You don't have to have that. You literally can just stop, drop your phone, don't record, be about it, action, and take care of it, okay? A big critical observation that I wanna make and say, document everything, okay? Or at least try to remember everything. Observation are critical for first responders. It would help with the patient's prognosis once we get on scene. Some influential factors, I would say, wound severity, blood loss, basically of the deterioration of the patient and their response to your treatment. And on average, I don't know if you guys know this, the human blood volume. So on average, the human has about 1.5 gallons of blood. Okay, think of a gallon milk, which as you can see on the screen, a gallon of milk and a half gallon of milk. That's how much blood you have in your body. I found that pretty fascinating. I've known that for some time, but when I first heard about it, it was pretty shocking. Up to 14% of blood loss can occur without symptoms or vital sign deviation. So you won't really see anything. 14% normal 26 fluid ounce Windex bottle. Think of that, okay? So severe blood loss reactions, though, between 30 and 40% of total blood loss. Manifests traumatic reactions, blood pressure, you know, dropping, an increased heart rate, confusion, disorientation, rapid and shallow breathing, okay? You might have to do artificial ventilations if it's rapid or shallow because they can't breathe on their own. As far as their blood pressure, there's really not much you can do other than plug the holes. And everything is compensating. So if your blood pressure drops and your heart races, and you're breathing pretty, you know, rapid or shallow, it's because your body's trying to compensate for the lack of fluids that you're losing. And as well, treat for shock. Anytime there's blood related like that, you're always gonna treat with shock with any significant blood loss, okay? That's very important. Shock can kill somebody, okay? Now the types of wounds, okay? So you're gonna have stab wounds, okay? So with stab wounds, they can be caused by sharp pointed objects, like knives, broken glass, poles, wood, it could be anything, okay? The characteristics, though, are pretty unique. So typically they're deep and they definitely have the potential for significant bleeding-inducing kind of style things. Now the requirements often necessitate like wound packing, to promote that healing and prevent complications, okay? So the pros, though, with stab wounds, actually, we're gonna do pros and cons of each one. The pros is it controls deep wound bleeding and aids in infection prevention and formation. And clot formation. Sorry, had to double check that. So yes, that's very true. Now, as far as the cons, though, difficulty in assessing wound depth and location, that's a big one. You might actually be fully hands-on and see some crazy things. Time insensitive and requires substantial gauze. That's very true. So make sure you have a lot of gauze. Okay. As you can see, these are what stab wounds look like. Once again, these are previous patients I've had in the past. Gunshot wounds. Okay, gunshot wounds. So the origin of those are inflicted by bullets or other projectiles. Okay. The characteristics can cause extensive tissue damage, often deep, extensive bleeding with, you know, the significant bleeding, actually. Sometimes you won't see significant bleeding. It just all depends. The treatment on average is you're going to do wound packing to manage the bleeding and promote healing. You might also substitute that with a chest seal, okay? The pros and cons for gunshot wounds, you're looking at controlled bleeding from large wounds, which is kind of a pro. You can kind of see it. Aids in infection and prevention and clot formation. So you're going to see duplicates of certain things as far as the pros with using gauze or hemostatic agents. So as far as the cons for it, once again, difficulty in finding things. The trajectory of bullets are amazing, especially with 22s. You can get shot right here and it's going to end up in your coming out your buttocks, or it might even not even come out at all. So, you know, just keep that in mind. You're always going to look for an entry and exit wound all the time. That's why you see EMTs or paramedics, fire, whatever it may be, cut everything, because we need to search everything and do a physical, like actual touch and feel kind of experience. So requires, once again, lots of gauze. They're ineffective for wounds with preforming clots. So with those preforming clots, like if there's a clot that's already there, it's kind of ineffective as far as with that gauze. So as I mentioned before, there's going to be more graphic photos. So as you can see, these graphic photos are basically what an entrance wound, what small looks like, and an exit wound can definitely be larger, especially with, once again, different types of calibers have different types of entry and exit wounds. So lacerations. Okay, lacerations are very simplistic as far as what they are. Okay, so deep cuts. Lacerations, a deep cut. So usually caused by sharp objects like broken glass or metal. Sheet metal cuts, man, those are the worst. Okay. The complexity of this too, the management can be definitely challenging due to the potential for significant bleeding. Okay. You could also nick an artery. It's very easy. We're not invincible, and there's a lot that can kind of happen. Now the treatment often requires wound packing to help promote that healing and manage that bleeding. Once again, the pros and cons, basically the same thing. The pros controls the wound bleeding and aids in healing and infection. Once again, difficulty in that finding that location, substantial gauze, and that specialized training to basically take care of it. Lots and lots of gauze, just pack, keep packing. There's a good photo of the laceration that one of my patients had. All right, so I know it's getting a little dry. So the types of wound packing materials, so there's a ton. You have gauze. Gauze is like acrylics, which is a type of gauze. It's made from cotton or a blend of cotton and synthetic fibers. It's soft, absorbent, and promotes clotting. It's used to absorb excess fluid and pack wounds. The pros to it, it's widely available and inexpensive. Okay, it can be easily cut to fit the size of a wound. It provides moderate absorbency and allows for visualization of the wound. Okay, so the cons of this, it can stick to the wound, causing further damage when removed. This is why you would wet it if it was an avulsion, or burn for that matter. It may not provide enough pressure to control significant bleeding, and it's definitely not effective for wounds with heavy bleeding located in hard to reach areas like your armpit or your internal groin area. With that being said, combat gauze. So the pros with combat gauze, which is a hemostatic agent, for controlling severe bleeding in trauma situations, is that it's a specialized gauze impregnated with a clotting agent. Okay, I'm gonna probably pronounce this and butcher the name, Caroline or Cetosan. Yeah, I'm gonna butcher that. Just know it's a hemostatic gauze that's gonna help clot that blood. It accelerates clotting, okay? And at least it accelerates that process, and it controls the bleeding when applied to bleeding wounds, okay? The cool thing with this, the pros, is it, once again, contains a hemostatic agent and promotes clotting way quicker than normal gauze. It definitely can be easily removed without causing further damage. However, you always want to pack as much gauze as you can if it soaks through. can be used for wounds with heavy bleeding and those hard to reach areas. And unfortunately, that does have a con, so it may not be readily as available. Other than wound packing materials can be more expensive other than wound packing materials. And it's not effective for wounds that are not actively bleeding, so it has to be actively bleeding. With another part is they do expire. So there is an expiration date on that versus normal gauze. Okay. So now steps on applying those wound materials. We're gonna be doing this demonstration video. I'm gonna be going over wound packing and what to look out for and whatnot. So we're gonna jump right in and I hope you guys enjoy that video. All right, welcome back. We are gonna be going over the wound packing video. Should be very quick, very self-explanatory after I show you guys. So with that being said, wound packing is basically used to control bleeding and deep wounds where direct pressure is not enough, okay? Hemostatic gauze accelerates clotting and can be more effective for controlling severe bleeding. And if you do not have hemostatic gauze, that's fine. Hemostatic gauze also only works if there is pretty severe bleeding, okay? That's probably when the best use it. Helps with the clotting and it takes less time to clot, roughly about 3 to 5 minutes, if less actually. So the signs indicating the need for like wound packing, okay? Profuse bleeding from a deep wound that doesn't stop with direct pressure, okay? That's a big one. And wound on like a junctional area, such as like the groin and armpit, where a tourniquet cannot be basically applied, effectively at least. That is where you're gonna be applying those wound packing. So for this, here is my dummy. I'm going to grab my gauze from ASA TechMed. And it does come, once again, we have an IFAT kit here. And the compressed gauze looks just like this. I'll go ahead and pull this out for you guys. It's going to come nice and tightly packed. All these packaging is going to come nicely packed. But for my demonstration, I've already taken it off to speed up the process. So packing wounds. Okay, you pack extremities and your groins. You can pack the neck, obviously not where, like, if you had like the trachea right here, you don't wanna, you know, do the airway. You do not do the chest cavity. It ain't gonna do you any good. So for this demo, it's gonna be a little awkward for me, but I will work with it. So what we're gonna do, gonna turn my dummy on his side. Let's just say this right here is going to be the wound I'm packing, okay? So obviously I'm going to unwrap it, get it so where it's still sterile. What I'm gonna end up doing is I'm going to obviously begin the process of applying pressure. So if once I get this out and I apply pressure, which I'm gonna go over what you're gonna be applying pressure to, once again, this is gonna be, let's just say lower. If it was an arterial bleed or anything like that, I'll explain what you're gonna do. So what you basically do is you're gonna wrap this around your finger, basically creating like a power ball. That's the best way I can describe it. It's gonna help you put pressure. So what I do is I get this little ball, okay? And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna find the artery, okay? Once I find that artery, yes, you are gonna go pretty like fingers deep. It could take all your fingers, it could take one, take two. For this, it's only gonna take two. All right, let's just do one for the training purpose because it's a little tight. And there is no flex in this plastic. Okay, so once you put and you find that artery, you're gonna put pressure and apply pressure on it. That should help with, and it doesn't take much. Arteries look like, the best way we can describe it, if I can find it, these rubber bands. They're about as thick as an artery. So it doesn't take much. So you're gonna take that power ball and you push it in there and you're gonna pinch it. Now the goal is, you can do is either peel like this. Z folds are nice because it's already not super tight, but this is good too. So what I'm gonna go ahead and do is continuously put pressure and just pack and never let my fingers off. It looks like I'm doing it, but I have direct pressure on this the entire time. Okay, and I'm packing in every crevice. Okay, so I'm basically gonna keep going until I fill up the wound. So the goal is to literally fill everything. So you're going left, right, up, down, packing and packing and packing until you basically fill everything up. Okay, so once you fill everything up, you basically apply that direct pressure on top of it. And then you would apply a pressure bandage to give you even more pressure, okay? And depending on how bad the bleeding is, you can use an Israeli pressure bandage, you could use a pressure bandage without the bar. There's a lot of ways you can do this. So once you pack this entire wound, so let's just say, we'll just say I'm packing it, and I'm pretty much finishing it up. I'm packing it as much as I can. Boom, I'm gonna apply a pressure, okay? While I'm applying that pressure, I'm gonna be talking to the patient, doing whatever I need to do. And we're gonna leave it out like this way. It's gonna be a little hard to do the pressure bandage, but we're gonna leave it like this. But this is basically how you wound pack, okay? So you're with basically overall the brief synopsis of everything is you're basically packing this wound, you're gonna powerball it, you're gonna find that artery, and once you find that artery, you'll be able to feel it and you're gonna put pressure on it. So it's important to know the anatomy of most arteries, okay? You have your carotid, your femoral, you have a ton of different, you know, arteries that run literally a good portion of the body, okay? So once you find that and you plug that, you should be good. If it's just oozing and it's not an arterial bleed, then you can still do the same concept to get, you know, that wound all plugged in. Because once again, you don't know how deep these wounds are. So once again, there you go. That is how to basically pack a wound. Obviously remember, in any video that I do, I'm already wearing gloves. So you always got to remember your PPE at all times. But that is it. Thank you for watching once again, and we're going to continue to our next section. All right, welcome back. So we are now in the wound packing conclusion, okay? So with that wound packing wound packing conclusion. All right, so with the wound packing conclusion, we just did the demonstration. I hope that was a better understanding of everything. Wound packing is a vital method for controlling deep wounds and promoting healing. And all of them have their advantages and their limitations, okay? Proper technique and training are crucial due to the life-saving role of wound packing, at least in trauma cases. And then as far as the leading cause of death for individuals under 45, bleeding out is one of them, as far as the wound packing goes. So education and training on wound packing and the packing techniques is crucial to increase the chances for survival for patients with deep wounds. And so by understanding these different materials and techniques available for the wound packing, healthcare professionals, first responders, and even yourself can effectively control bleeding, promote healing, and improve the outcome for any type of patient for that matter. And that's pretty much it. So once again, like I mentioned before, if you have any questions, concerns, or comments, you can email us at A as in Apple, M as in Mary, A as in Apple, V as in Victor, AR at onesourcesearchrescue.com, and that's A Mavar at onesourcesearchrescue.com. Or you can visit our website at www.onesourcesearchrescue.com, and you can go ahead and check out all that cool blog stuff and the kits we create and the services we offer. So once again, thank you for taking your time and watching this course. We are going to be moving into part two, which is going to be the intro into pressure bandages and tourniquets. So thank you and stay tuned.